Welcome to the Matt Sager Podcast, Thursday, December 27th. We're at the midway point between Christmas and my birthday, which is perhaps why I got a package from someone who completely ignored me on Christmas and will do so again on my birthday, with a towel in it. Yay, I got a towel. It's a very nice towel, and I appreciate the thought. I don't really know what the thought was, but listen, I don't mean to be a grumpy Scrooge type. I'm just having a more difficult than you would expect holiday season. That's all. This time of year is tough for many of us, and sometimes it's due to our own internal problems, sometimes it's external factors, and sometimes it's a toxic mix of the two, and I would say that's the category I'm encountering this time. But again, my birthday is still 4 days away. It could really turn everything around and utterly redeem this year, this holiday season. I'm not counting on that, but I'm not counting it out either. You know, miracles do happen. And speaking of, holy crap. If nothing else, I will take comfort in, you know, granted, this is a present for everybody, including those of us who are not celebrating holidays, but there's a Black Mirror movie, Bandersnatch, premiering tomorrow on Netflix. So that is, of course, obviously fantastic. Please don't let it be another Netflix movie that looks great and then becomes a Cloverfield Paradox kind of thing. I don't think that the creators and producers and showrunners of Black Mirror are capable of that. I think that in making this movie, one of their stipulations was that they don't skimp on the quality, budget, writing, anything. They've got their unimpeachable brand name, Black Mirror, attached to this project. I would be very surprised if it was anything short of fantastic. For tonight, I want to talk about my top 10 TV series of 2018. On December 24th, I did an episode of the top 10 TV episodes and then sent out a request to you asking whether you thought I should follow that same format when I count down the top series. That is to say, should I include streaming in addition to broadcast, cable, etc.? And the overwhelming response was yes. Who cares if it's Netflix? Who cares if it's Amazon Prime, Hulu, DC Universe? We're living in a new world. It would be like saying, I'm going to do a top 10 news pieces of the year and separate newspaper in print form from stuff I read online. We all got to adjust to this new world, and TV, maybe it'll change its terminology someday as we all start switching to tablets and TVs with streaming apps built into them as being just the default new television. So the bottom line is this is a top 10 TV series that includes network, cable, premium channels like HBO, and streaming services such as Netflix, Hulu, Amazon Prime, etc. Number 10, Daredevil. I wish I could put this show higher because I've got a deep affection for this show, and I feel a great sense of loss that season 3 was the final season. It may well have ended up being higher on this list if not for the fact that season 3, while very good, was its least even, least consistently exciting and well-paced season. It was great, but like I said, it's a number 10 show this year. Number 9, Bob's Burgers. You know, Fox, once The Simpsons happened, and then again when Family Guy debuted, Fox realized and woke the rest of the world up to the idea that animation for grown-ups, which can also be enjoyed by children, is consistently of high quality, consistently brings in huge ratings. A fan base that even once they tire of it, like The Simpsons, still number in the hundreds of millions, and which can go on indefinitely. These voice actors, like everyone else, they age, they put on weight, they lose weight, and that is a worry that they don't have with this cast, because they're all behind the microphone. Similarly, there's no makeup, there's no wardrobe, there's no set pieces, and they found a way to outsource animation to make it extremely inexpensive to create. And yet, out of all those Fox shows, I would say that most of them have been stripped of what once made them very, very special. Simpsons, I can't watch it anymore. Family Guy, I'm able to sit through it, but there's no enjoyment at all. Just in the last 3 years alone, the decline in quality on that show has been precipitous. And that's in part because nobody involved wants to do it anymore. Seth MacFarlane's been pretty vocal about, you know, I think I should have canceled it in season 7, but I've got all these nice people working for me, so what am I going to do? That's all well and good for him, but for us, the viewers, that is not a wonderful description for an animated series that they want us to tune into every week. Bob's Burgers is reminiscent of early Simpsons. Although the animation, as I said, is outsourced, at least in large part, and done in a sort of assembly line process overseas, it looks extremely homegrown, homemade, personalized. The voice cast is amazing. H. John Benjamin, of course, is amazing as Bob. Eugene Merman as Gene, hilarious. Kristen Schaal as Louise is amazing. And of course, there's two men, each of whom play women, and they're among the best of this wonderful, hilarious voice cast. Dan Mintz as Tina Belcher, butts, butts, butts. And John Roberts as Linda. They're both wonderful. The show is fantastic. And unlike all the other animated series I've named, this show continues to only get better season by season. They have not yet reached that tipping point where things get a little rocky for a couple years and then begin to decline. And as far as I know, they never will. You know, until they show signs that they're running out of steam, beginning to lose the knack for new and original ideas for each episode, as far as I'm concerned, they're just good and getting better. Or rather, I should say great. It is a great show. If you're not watching Bob's Burgers, perhaps because you've just tired of Fox's Sunday night animation lineup, I'm telling you, this is a different animal. It's a wonderful, hilarious show, and you're cheating yourself if you're not watching it. Number 8, another animated series, and a reason to subscribe to Cinemax. Mike Judge's Tales from the Tour Bus. I'm amazed that this isn't a much bigger deal. First of all, Mike Judge is a big star in the world of animation. Each of his shows has always been extremely cutting edge, wildly original, incredibly entertaining, and Tales from the Tour Bus is no exception. If anything, it is a notch above King of the Hill, which I realize, even to my own ears, that sounds like blasphemy. But he tells the true stories. In season one, he did country music with artists like Johnny Paycheck, and season two got so much better because he covered funk music and funk musicians. So we saw George Clinton, there were two-parters for each Rick James and James Brown, Bootsy Collins appeared in just about every episode this season in animated form, and it's these true stories, and rather than voice actors, in most instances, as long as the artist is alive, you're hearing it from the artists themselves. It's just their image that is animated by Mike Judge, who also appears in animated form interstitially in between segments and to introduce and close out episodes to talk about his own personal insight and affections for and fondness of these stories and these musicians and bands. And boy, you know, as great as Mike Judge has always been, the fact that he continues to be so bold and experimental and that now he's sharing this really personal thing, his love and affinity for musicians with us, it's a fantastic show. Number 7. The Haunting of Hill House, an extremely loose adaptation. Based on is almost overstating it, but it is inspired, certainly, by the classic Shirley Jackson horror novel of the same name. It is many things. It is, of course, a horror show, and if it only did that, with the level of high quality that it does, it would probably still be number 7 on this list. But it's so much more than that. It's all about psychological trauma, trauma inflicted on kids and how they carry that with them into their adulthood, trauma that lives on in inanimate things like homes, houses. I'm a big, big fan. I binge-watched that a couple of times this year and will likely do it at some point before the new year. I suggest you do the same. It's on Netflix now. Number 6, American Crime Story, The Assassination of Gianni Versace from FX. This was one of the best acting performances I've seen in the last, I don't know, 5-10 years. Darren Criss as Andrew Cunanan is amazing. He is terrifying, ruthless, sad, arrogant. He is a fantastic actor, and the story is told in such a riveting way. Thing about true crime stories is that in many cases, we know much of what we're going to see, and it's just about how well the actor interprets that for us and helps us to relive that experience. Thankfully, not as participants, but, you know, as people who were voyeurs at the time, reading about it in the press, etc. This also fleshed out the story and told us all kinds of things we didn't already know. In particular, starting the show with the big shooting of Gianni Versace and then working its way backwards before looping around back to where the season premiere started for the explosive season finale. But in going back in time, you get to watch Cunanan in his many forms. As a kid, very troubled, and his troubled family, about whom I knew nothing prior to this. I now know a lot about them. I also know that he killed many people on his way to shooting Gianni Versace. He left a trail of blood behind him everywhere he went. He was a broken man, and the way he expressed that to the world, at first it was with these great, sort of upsetting emotional outbursts. And then one day he discovered violence, embraced it, and never really let go. And Darren Criss did a spectacular job at capturing this. The whole cast was quite good. It's just that Darren Criss is one of these people I've never seen before and just couldn't believe how talented he was. And a performance that is just illuminating, inspiring, and again, very, very chilling. Number 5. Glow. Netflix is winning a lot on this list, but that's because it's got such great programming. Glow, in particular, is a very impressive show. It's the semi-true story, again, based on a true story, of Glow, the Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling, which was actually a big phenom in the 80s. And it tells the tale of how it came to be, all the wacky and somewhat dysfunctional and really brilliant and lovable characters who made it what it was. And whatever the opposite of a sophomore slump is, that is what GLOW experienced this year with season two. As great as the first season was, this built on it, tried all these new storytelling techniques, allowed the cast to really explore their characters, allowed the writers the same privilege, and in so doing, created one of the best seasons of TV this year, another one which I love very dearly. Netflix really dominated this year, more than most. And speaking of, number four, Ozark. If you haven't watched Ozark, and you're at all a fan of The Wire, Breaking Bad, Better Call Saul, I don't mean to compare it to those shows because it's got very little in common with them other than that the lead, Jason Bateman, the main lead, along with Laura Linney, is someone who you know primarily as a comedic foil. And apparently it's only because no one's ever asked him, hey, can you also do gritty, creepy, likable, but rather evil and deeply morally compromised anti-heroes? It's a shame that he hasn't been asked to do that prior to now because it turns out he's an absolute natural at this. Everyone on this show is fantastic, including my Twitter buddy, Kevin L. Johnson, who plays Sam Dermody, the real estate agent, who continues to have a pretty major role in this show. I cannot wait for season three. And in case you're wondering who Sam Dermody is, this is where we first meet him on Ozark.
Oh, yeah. Don't be shy. You know what to do. Come on, baby. It's all for you. Just gobble it up. Oh, yeah. Get after it.
That is a dog eating peanut butter, but not in the way you think. It is nowhere near as creepy as it sounds, but it is hilarious. And yes, in telling this gruesome, frightening story that forces us all to look at our own moral decisions and how they may seem harmless, but, you know, when you make one wrong choice, or one choice that says, ah, what can it hurt? That the answer to that question can be more than you could have ever reckoned with or bargained for. Everyone on this show is dealing with the repercussions of being asked that sort of question and answering just a little bit wrong in ways that are continuing to haunt them and erode at their character, their morals, and their very souls. Ozark rules. You really need to watch it. Number three, HBO's Barry, fronted by Bill Hader. This is many things. It's a crime drama. It's a comedy show. It's a drama about a man caught between two worlds who wants more than anything to be a performer and whose past is shrouded in tragedy, trauma, in almost unimaginable amount of guilt that he carries with him and that he's trying so hard to escape from, even as he tries to make the move from a hitman to an actor. And while it's true that show business is murder, murder is the last thing he wants to do. But again, Barry made a choice one day, and he's still haunted by it and is still desperately trying to escape it with the help of acting teacher Henry Winkler. Well, played by Henry Winkler. And Winkler, as always, is whatever the script calls for him to be. Dramatic, comedic, passionate, silly, angry, serious. The entire cast is spectacular, and Barry is amazing, and if you're not watching it, you're crazy. Especially if you're a performer, because even though it is ostensibly about a hitman who wants to be an actor, this is an expression of the anxiety that Bill Hader felt early in his career, and that to some extent he doubtless still fears. It is a very universal set of anxieties that performers feel. I mean, not me. I'm totally fine. No worries here. But yeah, no, in general, we angst out a lot. We don't go around committing murder, but we have that same level of guilt, of imposter syndrome, of the constant need to please, or the terror of what awaits us if we fail to do so. This is a brilliant expression of that. Number two. Oh boy, this was very hard. Just like with the movies, this was very difficult to not make this show number one. But number two, you've heard me speak about this show ad nauseum on this podcast, BoJack Horseman. Just wrapped its fifth season on Netflix, its best season yet, which is amazing for a show like this. One which follows the same cycle year after year, but with dramatically different themes and subtext and ways in which they're propelling the show forward and advancing the character arcs. I know it is a cartoon about animals. I get that. Just watch season one. You need to get a little bit into season one before you understand. This is a magical realism telling of, again, the damage that the entertainment industry can do to you, the way it can rack your soul, the way childhood trauma can both inform that, maybe lead you down that path to begin with, and certainly make you predisposed to falling into all the worst show business traps of narcissism, self-loathing, self-destruction. And for BoJack, the cycle to which I referred earlier to is that of the search for redemption and the acknowledgement that he's a bad person, as he calls it, and wants to be good. And in Diane, played by Alison Brie, he is constantly reminded that you don't just get to be a good person or a bad person. The person you are is the things that you do. So BoJack, stop doing terrible things and start doing good things. And then you'll be a good person until you start doing shitty things again, at which point you'll be a bad person. By the end of season 5, it looks like he may have actually grasped this, which sets us up for a very different season 6. Whether it's for the better or for the worse, whether there's a relapse that he experiences, that's highly likely. But in any case, it is an incredibly deep, thoughtful, satisfying, and just generally brilliant show. And at number 1, this was a very difficult decision to make. As I said, the urge to put BoJack in that top spot is always there. However, in examining all the TV I've watched this year, this is a show that has been brilliant from the very start, and this year really kicked it up a notch, and is ultimately the best thing I've seen on TV this year. It is absolutely the number one show, and if you're not watching it, you're nuts. And so, out of all these great series, the number one television show of 2018 is this.
Big reason I became a lawyer was Chuck. He was the most brilliant man I ever knew. And an incredible lawyer, you know, and he knew exactly who he was. Exactly.
That is a man who does not know exactly who he is. He's currently known as Gene and working at Assiniboine. We knew him best in Breaking Bad as Saul Goodman from the episode he debuted in, Better Call Saul, which is the name of the TV series that he currently helms. The amazing Bob Odenkirk as Jimmy McGill, soon to be Saul, much later to be Gene, in Better Call Saul. This series is now on par with Breaking Bad. It somehow enhances Breaking Bad. Watching Breaking Bad after watching Better Call Saul is a more fulfilling experience than it was before. And these characters, these wonderful, not ancillary, but not leading roles on Breaking Bad, now have their own story set in the past and leading up to the events of Breaking Bad and fleshing out these characters. The Salamanca crew, Hector and Tuco, Ignacio or Nacho, who is only referred to in that episode of Breaking Bad called Better Call Saul. Lots of deep diving into the psyche and methodology of Mike Ehrmantraut and now Gus Fring, Lydia Rodart Quayle, and many others. It is the best show on TV. And if you think I'm wrong, please do let me know. Because if there's something better than this, I want to be watching it. So get in touch with the Matt Sager Podcast. You can email matt@mattsager.com or call me at 646-535-4788. Also, you can get me on social media. On Twitter, I'm at Matt Sager. On Instagram, I'm Real Matt Sager. And on Facebook, I'm The Matt Sager. You can also check out my voiceover page there, Matt Sager VO. And please like, subscribe to this podcast page, which is Matt Sager Podcast. Also, look in the links for the description for tonight's podcast episode. There are links there for my Patreon and my merch store for my good friends at WeHaveMerch.com. And as for the rest, my voiceover reels, more ways to get in touch with me, my contact info, articles, blog posts, more social media links, and much, much more. You can find all that at mattsagervoiceover.com.